Welcome back, friends and followers, to another edition of A New Way to Museum. My name is Curtis Schmidt. I'm the Zoological Collections Manager, and...
My name is Dr. Allie Baumgartner. I am the Paleontology Collections Manager here at the Sternberg Museum.
So what we're going to talk to you about today is what we do. So what do collections managers do? Because it turns out not a whole lot of people know what we do here at the museum. So to start, you know, when you walk through the lobby of our museum, most people look at it and they're here for a reason. They're here to go upstairs and look at the nice, fancy displays and exhibits and things like that. What they don't realize is most natural history museums, whether they're small like the Sternberg or large like the Smithsonian, are built around their scientific collections, which are typically off limits and not seen by the general public. So we have a small fraction of those up on exhibit. So I'm gonna go through, as the Zoological Collections Manager, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about what I take care of, okay? So I have a list here. I take care of 6 different collections, which is quite a bit for me to take care of. So that includes herpetology, which is amphibians and reptiles. I have 17,991 catalog specimens as of 5 minutes ago. Mammalogy, the study of mammals, 43,704. Ichthyology, which is fish, 29,333 lots of specimens. So each fish does not get cataloged. Lots of fish from the same spot get cataloged.
And there are lots of fish in a lot.
A lot of fish in a lot. There could be one fish in a lot. There could be 300 fish in a lot. Entomology, that's one collection we don't have a really good count on, but we're probably thinking around 100,000 specimens because it's not digitized. It's not computerized yet. It's one of the things I'm working on. So that is insects. Ornithology is birds, one of our smaller collections. We have approximately 8,000 specimens and about 540 osteology specimens. So with birds, unfortunately, you either get a skinned and stuffed bird or you get a skeleton. You don't get the luxury of having both like you do with mammals. So, and then the final collection I take care of is invertebrate zoology, which is the collection that's growing very, very rapidly here. We have just over 6,000 specimens there in those collections.
So I am responsible for both fewer and smaller collections than Curtis. So as the Paleontology Collections Manager, I am in charge of the vertebrate paleontology collections. So that's going to be the things with bones, the invertebrate paleontology collections, so the things without bones, and the geology collection, which is not alive. So the vertebrate paleontology collection is our largest. There are about 20,000 things in vert paleo. There are actually about 200 of them that are up on display. So about 1% of the paleontology collections are up on exhibit. The invertebrate paleontology collection is much smaller. It's about 2,000 specimens, so about an order of magnitude smaller than vertebrate paleontology. And then the smallest collection that is rapidly growing is the geology collection. So I got a bunch of rocks, a lot of meteorites, and that's roughly 1,000 specimens.
So what all goes into managing these collections? I actually teach a course in collections management, and the thing that I stress the most, and it comes up numerous times throughout the semester, is the number one goal is to know what you have and know where to find it. You'll hear that over and over again. That is our primary
yes.
job right there. And whether it's online or in a database or in a cabinet, we need to know how to quickly access mm-hmm. the specimens and the data. So that's very, very important. Another thing that we have to work on a lot is storage and security of the specimens. So how are they stored? Are they away from the elements? Are they away from anything that's going to deteriorate the specimens at all? And things that you don't think about, like humidity, temperature, even light, can deteriorate these specimens, whether they're fossils or they're modern specimens. So those are the things that we have to control to the best of our abilities to make sure nothing is going to deteriorate any of these specimens. Now, the ones that I have to take care of, so I have two primary areas within the zoology collection. I have wet collections, which almost everything is stored in alcohol. Then I have dry collections, which are in cabinets and kept dry. So two of the things I need to worry about are A, keeping insects that are going to eat the pelts and the things like that in the dry collection out of the collection, but then going back to the wet collection, making sure there's always plenty of alcohol in those jars. Because, you know, you get a cracked lid, you get a lid that's not put on correctly, it's going to quickly evaporate. When you have as many specimens as I do,
yes,
that can be really hard to find and keep track of. So that's a big part of my job, is making sure that those things stay where they're at. Because the whole idea of any collection, whether it's paleontology or zoology, is to make these specimens be around forever, and the associated data as well. So if they don't have collection data that come with them, they're really useless to us for scientific purposes.
They're fancy doorstops.
They're fancy doorstops, or they're good for teaching collections and things like that. So I'm going to turn it over to Allie now, who's going to talk a little bit about how we do these things and how we organize these things.
Yeah, so one more thing about taking care of our collections, though. So I don't have to worry about keeping wet collections wet and dry collections dry, but I have one more problem that Curtis doesn't have, because I'm dealing with rocks, literally in terms of the geology collection, but rocks and fossils with the vertebrate and invertebrate paleontology, and that's pyrite disease, which you might not think about fossils getting sick, but it is something that is contagious. And it is just the presence of iron pyrite in a fossil, and if it is exposed to humidity, it will change. There will be a chemical reaction that will cause more basically the spread of the pyrite, and if it is left untreated, can cause the fossil to explode. It also, one of the side effects is sulfuric acid. All of these things are bad. So this is another thing that we need to constantly monitor for, and that's another reason why we need to monitor the humidity. So in addition to helping, you know, his stuff getting taken care of, you'd think the rocks were fine. No, rocks are far more fragile than you think. But yeah, so as he said, we have to organize these things. And as he mentioned, I say it too, I need to know what I have and where to find it. So the way that we organize things is going to be different between the two of us, and honestly, between every collection that we have. Because one of the most important things that we need to be able to do as collections managers is know where to find something, and the only way to do that is if it's organized. And so that's something that we're constantly working on. So in paleontology, there are a couple different ways that we can organize our collections. We will organize them broadly by vertebrate or invertebrate, but within that we have options of, is it arranged based on where it's found and the age of it? Is it based on what type of organism it is? So, you know, generally fish will go together, sharks will go together, things like that. But not even just physically in space, knowing where everything is, you know, labeling our cabinets so we have numbers so we know who is in there. We'll label the cabinet and also the drawers within it. But that corresponds to our online database. So that way, we can double check all of these things, that this thing is supposed to be in this place. I can see it here. The database says that. Go team. Everybody agrees. We will also have often physical catalogs. So we will have data in as many places as we possibly can, in addition to filing cabinets where we'll have field notes and the like, basically to make sure that all of the data, so that the fossil itself, all of the data associated with it, and even the other information regarding, you know, the history of how it got here is all taken care of. Without organization, again, we don't know what we have and we don't know where it is, and that makes it kind of useless to science. So based on the past year, we've had a lot of people who are trying to do research but can't always come to the collection. So there are a couple of different ways that researchers can use the collection, because honestly, that is the main reason that we have it. It's not to go up on display, it's for researchers to use. And so some people will come to the museum, but we will also issue loans. So a loan, it's just what it sounds like. We will send them the stuff, and it's far more complicated than that. There's a lot of paperwork involved, because we need to make sure that before we send anything, we know exactly the status of it. We know the state that the fossil or whatever you're sending was in before it gets sent. We literally do paperwork in triplicate. A copy for them, a copy for us, and a copy for them to return with the fossil when they return it. Just to make sure that we want people to be able to access our fossils, be able to study our fossils, but we also want to make sure that they're not the last person who gets to do so. So that everything is, if anything happens to it, if anything is broken, that gets documented. It happens. Fossils are fragile. Yeah, so we will do that just to make sure that everybody gets a chance to study things. We'll also do virtual. We will scan things for people and send them the scans. That takes less paperwork. That one's nice. And then sometimes people can come and they will visit our collections. And that is honestly one of the most exciting things for me. I learn so much when researchers come to the collections, because the whole point of this is for, we don't want to just like fill cabinets with fossils and specimens that never see the light of day. We want there to be active research. We want these things to be used by the public. So we will have researchers come. I've got two in the next month who are coming to look at our material, measure it, and hopefully publish on it so that we can continue to grow the collection and get more money, because the more people use it, the more money that we get to take care of it, because we can demonstrate a need for it. And so I kind of touched on it a little bit, but our digital collections are very important. So we have our online databases. In paleontology, we have a front end and a back end. So the back end has got all of the boring information that's really useful to me. The front end is searchable by anyone. So researchers, members of the public who just want to see pretty pictures of mosasaurs, like, highly recommend it. We digitized all of that. So you can see what we have before you come, or you can see what we have before you request a loan. You might find out that, hey, we already took the pictures you needed. Don't need to come. We can send you the high resolution photos and you're all good to go. And that is why digitization is so important. In the last few years or so, we've had multiple grants in paleontology working towards digitizing our collections. So all of our collections are in this database, except for geology. We're working on it, I'm trying. So that is all searchable, but not everything has a picture. And that is really important to make sure that everybody's on the same page. And the pictures are really useful, not just for researchers, but also for me, so I can make sure that it's the right thing, because I can just take a look at the picture.
Imagine the difficulty in sending out a mosasaur specimen.
Oh my God, I've done that. The first loan that I packed up while I was here was a mosasaur skull. It was this big, and I had to, oh my goodness, side note, the way that we pack things is double box them. So we take the skull, you wrap it in as much bubble wrap as you have, you put that in a box, fill that with as much like packing material as you can. You very gently shake it to make sure that it's not gonna move in there, that it's stuck tight. And then you put that box in another box and you fill that box with packing peanuts to make sure that nothing's gonna happen to it. It ended up being a huge box at the end. Sorry.
Probably weighed a ton.
Yes, it did, because it was literally about two boxes full of rocks. So this is really important. I want to help people engage with the collection as much as we can. It's part of the reason why I share Fossil Friday social media things, to show people what we have, because not everyone knows. It's not always obvious that, you know, somebody in Kansas is going to have honestly, we have so many really cool things. We have so many holotypes here. Like, we got the good stuff. But I am limited to rocks, and you know, my most recent stuff is still thousands of years old. So I'm still limited in the types of research that's being done on it. It tends to be a lot of, like, we measure stuff. Paleontology, we just love measuring stuff. But you got more options with your stuff.
Lots of options, yes. So with the zoology collection, everything that she just said is relevant to the zoology collection as well. There's one more thing that I forgot to mention before that we collect that obviously they don't, because it's soft tissue, are tissue samples. Because a lot of the research that's going on these days throughout the world is looking at DNA and molecular research. Everything that we come in that's a modern specimen, we pull a tissue sample, we store the tissue sample, and we have it available for researchers. So that's probably the number one loan that I send out right now is tissue samples for people that are looking at DNA. And they use it for a variety of purposes. I mean, they're looking at how things are related, they're looking at speciation, evolution, things like that. So, anything else?
I think that collections management is highly underrated.
Very much so.
I think that I have the best job.
No, I have the best job.
We have the best job.
We have the best
job. We have the best job. So even though we are alone in our very dark basements, our jobs are literally opening up cabinets and seeing what's inside and making sure that everything is there that's supposed to be. And my first day of work, I realized that my job was opening the cabinets and seeing the cool things inside. And it's really exciting. But as he said at the very beginning, a lot of people don't understand what we do. So don't be afraid to talk to your friendly neighborhood collections manager. We are really excited about helping people know the world around them, either in the deep past or even up until today. So please send some love to your local collections managers.
And also, one of the things we've been talking about doing is starting up a collections tour for the public. So once COVID goes away and we can allow more people in here,
yes,
that's something we're going to be looking at. So the public, the general public, can come back and see the different collections and how big they are.
Yes, I'm a fossil librarian. He's a librarian of dead things. And that's the thing that I really look forward to doing next, is being able to show people, like, we got cool stuff back here.
That's right. Well, thank you guys for tuning in, and we'll catch you next time.
Bye.
Thanks for joining us in A New Way to Museum with the Sternberg Museum of Natural History. If you enjoyed this video, like it and subscribe to our channel. Hit the bell for notifications when we release a new video. Support us on Patreon for early access and exclusive content. You can also follow us on all our social media. Links are found in the description. Thanks for watching, and follow your curiosity to new discoveries.